So we'll move on. The next session is actually a very, very important talk, and I think most of us get this wrong. And we cannot keep our patients happy if we don't get this right. So I'm quite pleased to introduce the speaker, Dr. Dominic Benjamin, who is actually a consultant geriatrician and diabetic specialist for older people, currently working in Baptist Hospital, Bangalore. He's also a Professor of Medicine, International Medical School, Bangalore Campus, Management and Science University, Malaysia. He is actually a properly trained geriatrician by the looks of the CV. He has done the certificate of completion training in UK in geriatrics. After doing post-graduation in medicine in India, then he left to UK. He is also trained in diabetes in UK, and he's come back, and he's actually started the Department of Geriatrics at Bangalore Baptist Hospital. And he's going to tell us about pain management in elderly population, cautions and limitations. I hope I've done justice in introducing you, sir.
Thank you, Chairman. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I think we'll shift gears. We'll just go to pain in older people. I just want to thank the organizers at the outset and Dr. Chandrasekhar in particular for choosing this topic. It's quite a pertinent topic, and also is a very pervasive symptom which a lot of people suffer with. I hope at the end of my talk, you know, you will look at pain from a different perspective. You know, that's what I want to think. Now, we make our life complicated by where we are. You know, I was not used to one-way Bangalore, so coming to this place was a bit of a difficult. I'm coming to this place after 15 years. So this is a picture, the internet map, of one institute in the US. So that's how complicated things get. Pain can be even more complicated. Now, if you look at the picture on the left side of your thing, it shows a healthy brain. And all the blue activity shows that it's a normal electrical activity. But look at the picture on the other side, which shows red and white patches, which suggests that there's a lot of pain going on in the patient with fibromyalgia. So sometimes brain can act as a voltometer as to how pain has been going on in this patient. Now, when I was a medical student and I was a junior doctor, I used to take pain as one of the symptoms which patients sort of, you know, come and tell you, and they just go on and on about it sometimes. But I think as I sort of seen both sides of the pond, things have changed the way I perceive pain. Now, pain has multiple dimensions. Now, I mean, before that, we'll go to what is pain. This is a definition from the International Society of Pain, which says that pain is any unpleasant sensory and emotional experience associated with actual or potential tissue damage. Pain is whatever patient says it hurts is pain. Now, the diagram on the other side shows the gate control theory of pain, which was put forth just 1965. It's almost coming up to 50 years by Melvack and Wall, which says that, you know, nociceptive stimuli coming from the periphery will be sort of intercepted. And also there'll be influence of your brain as well. Now, we have moved on. We have what is called as a neuromatrix theory of pain. You know, we'll come to that later. So I think, but what we have learned over the years is that there are multiple dimensions of pain. So this is Melzack and Wall, again, proposing there are five dimensions of pain. The sensory dimension of pain is that what you sense in your five senses. That's a sensory dimension of pain. Affective is that how your emotion reacts to pain. You know, pain brings about anxiety, fear, trepidations. Cognitive effect of pain, you know, we'll come to that later, that pain by itself can cause cognitive impairment, loss of attention, you know, poor concentration, unable to complete task. Okay. Then memory of pain. I mean, memory of pain is definitely something that we need to bear in mind. And visit to a dentist is never a pleasing thing, because we know how painful it is. So the memory of pain is evoked. And then autonomic response to pain. So pain is a multidimensional response. That's one thing I just want to drive home very clear, that pain has multidimensional response. Now, this is a classification of pain based on the etiology. The pain is divided into neuropathic pain, nociceptive pain, mixed pain, and, you know, you have dysfunctional pain, a whole lot of things going on. So if you look at the thing here, the most of the older people, by the way, for me, old is 85 plus, please, thank you. At 65, I normally counsel them, do you want to have a change of, you know, car or partner or whatever it is. You know, I think 85 plus is, I would consider entertain the diagnosis of old. So In people, as they advance in age, the pain that you experience is more of the neuropathic pain that you experience is diabetic neuropathy, post-herpes neuropathy, neuralgias, and also radicular pain. And this is something that I want you to take note. It's a central pain which we tend to forget. 8% of the stroke patients will have some sort of a central pain, which we tend to ignore, which you not take it seriously. But 25% of patients with multiple sclerosis, the predominant symptom will be pain. And same thing with Parkinson's disease as well. So we don't tend to, we are not being sort of accustomed to take pain a bit more seriously. And also it's a bit of a cultural thing, I think. A lot of people come and say, look, I'm past certain age and I need to bear with pain. Let me bear with it, you know. So you need to be mindful of that. But if you look at it, the majority of the painful sort of people present with pain or pain from musculoskeletal dimension. It's more of a pain in the back or, you know, generalized body pain, neck pain, things like that. And also visceral pain. But I mean, majority of them are sort of arthritis type of pain, osteoarthritis and low back pain. 1 in 5 adult in US, older adult, suffers with chronic pain. So I think it's a very pertinent problem and pervasive problem. And you do have mixed pain. I circled it here for you. That, you know, patients who have cancer can have 30 to 40% of mixed pain. They can have neuropathic pain as well. Okay. And you have high number of patients presenting with low back pain and neck pain as well. Now, I'll stick to more to chronic pain and non-cancer pain. Okay. So I think acute pain, we know there is an insult and there's a response to insult. Okay. You treat the insult, the pain comes down. There's a clear temporal relationship. So the acute pain. So any pain that lasts less than 3 months is an acute pain. It's normally a response to a noxious stimuli, but trauma, surgery. Whereas chronic pain lasts for more than 3 to 6 months. There's significant interplay of emotion, cognitive behavior, physiological adaptation that can happen over the patient's clinical course. Now, unfortunately, patients don't, even the doctors don't sort of measure pain. Pain should be one of the vital signs that needs to be measured. And there are different scales for measuring pain. We have visual analog score, the 0 to 10 score, the faces diagram. But these are not very much sort of validated in older people. This doesn't give you the multi dimensions of pain that I mentioned about. So, but MGDL pain questionnaire looks at how we perceive pain, how is the pain going, and temporal relationship of pain. And also the other one is a brief pain inventory, which takes about the short form of it and a longer form of it, which takes about 5 minutes for a shorter form. It gives you about how patient feels about pain, both in the temporal sense and also the sensory components. So also it helps you to him to sort of map out his pain. Now, the various factors that sort of makes one sort of experience pain, it's all the way we are wired. Some people are more threshold for pain, some people are less threshold for pain, whether they have central or peripheral sensitization, is there ongoing inflammation. Also cognitive factors, the memory of pain, you know, how the coping styles are. So, and also you need to bear in mind that the history of previous pain can also affect the way they manifest or experience pain. And emotional factors as well. I think studies have shown that people who are going through marital separations can present with inherent pain that may not be there. It's more of perceived pain. Now, so pain affects all parts of a life. You know, it affects your sleep, it affects your normal functioning, it affects your leisurely activities. It also affects your marital relationship with other people. It also affects your social dimension. You tend to get ostracized, you don't tend to go out. And also it brings down your function. It's disabling. And also it has a health consequence as well. So, I mean, yeah, there's more disability, loss of productivity, and they're more irritable, angry, and anxious, and sort of they're more sort of grumpy lot, you know what I mean? So I think that's what I want to drive home, that chronic pain is an illness by itself. Many times you may see a patient with rheumatoid arthritis complaining of pain, but I mean you may tend to look at the pain and not dwell on the pain. I think you would dwell on the rheumatoid arthritis. I would just to say that you need to give due importance to pain as well. Now, coming to pain in older people, we know that incidence of pain goes up till the age of 70, and after that it sort of plateaus. And older people are more likely to experience pain in the major joints. And older people tend to underreport. Most of them are very stoic. You know, they don't want to say that I'm in pain, especially the alpha males, you know what I mean? So they don't say I'm in pain. They tend to have more faith, thank God for this. They have more faith in the medical system, and that's what the survey shows. Cognitive impairment will sort of blunt the way they sort of manifest pain, or the way they sort of talk about the pain. So you need to be mindful of that, especially with patients with dementia. I think there are different sort of way to sort of assess pain in them. Now, this is a study which is published in 2001, which says that pain affects different aspects of cognition. It makes you more forgetful. You're more prone to minor accidents. They have difficulty to finish tasks. They have attention difficulty as well. So more than half the patient experience some form of cognitive impairment or cognitive effect because of chronic pain. So you need to, especially when you're dealing with any chronic long-term disease, you need to manage pain very well. Now, if your chronic pain is normally associated with deconditioning, there are different psychological disorders. You have mood disturbances and what is called as catastrophization. What does it mean? It just means that once individual starts experiencing pain, he said, oh, my life is going to be hell. This is the way it's going to be. It's not worth living. So that's what it means. There are different type of catastrophization, but I think that's what one of the things that happens with chronic pain. And also this progressive functional impairment. And this leads to vicious cycle of pain. What does it mean? If you don't treat them, they become maladaptive, they go into downward spiral, and they sort of land up in a chronic pain state. Okay. This picture is, we are more familiar with, the WHO the WHO step ladder. But so I think we need to sort of, we'll discuss about it a bit later. But chronic pain should be managed as illness, and sort of our aim should be to improve the quality of life of the individual. Now, before we start talking about the drugs, I just want to make a brief mention of the pharmacokinetics. I think the previous speaker made a few mentions about it. All phases of pharmacokinetics are affected with aging, including the absorption, distribution, metabolism, and elimination as well. Older people tend to require lower dose of medication. The thing what we use is start low and go very slow. And absorption is also irregular in older people because of delayed transit time and malabsorption. And volume of distribution of most drugs is smaller in older people. And older people tend to have low lean body mass. They have impaired hepatic metabolism and renal clearance as well. Although we have a lot of things at our disposal, but I think as medics, we tend to more skewed towards the pharmacological things. That is something that I learned when I was associated with pain clinic. We think in a totally different way compared to a non-medic nurse pain specialist who's managing. She's more independent, more objective. So although we have pharmaceutical medications which are available for chronic pain, we have surgical therapy as well, there's neuro-augmentative therapy, somatic behavioral rehabilitation, but we tend not to use all of them. And that's one of the reasons why the overall treatment effectiveness of chronic pain is fairly poor. I think even though they're saying that even if you treat the pain well, it doesn't reflect on the quality of life. So there are a lot of other things that's going on. Now, just brief mention about the difference between neuropathic pain and nociceptive pain. So neuropathic pain, it's a lancinating shooting type of pain. They more often have a neurological weakness. They could have autonomic dysfunction with that, autonomic changes with that, whereas nociceptive pain is more of a throbbing in nature. They may not have a neurological weakness per se, but pain can induce weakness. There is no distal radiation, and unlikely to have autonomic signs as well. Now, coming to the medications, non-steroidal drugs are quite effective. It's well used, and it's widely available. It's available in oral form. And there are different combinations available. So I think it's a mainstay of treatment for mild to moderate pain. But I think many a times we don't use it effectively. Now, I use very few drugs. I think maybe the rheumatologist would use more of them. I tend to use a good amount of paracetamol and very rarely naproxen or diclofenac or etodolac. So what are the different types of non-steroidals? You have salicylate, which is very good, but you need to use it in high dose, between and the phenol derivatives, that is paracetamol, which is a very good drug to use. Propionic acid derivatives, ibuprofen, ketoprofen, and naproxen is good, but naproxen is better compared to other two. Acetic acid drugs, diclofenac is available. Indomethacin, I don't see many people using it. Etodac, and enolic acid derivatives and COX-2 inhibitors as well. Now, one of the things that I sort of learned from Western world is that if you treat pain on a regular scheduled base, they're more likely to respond. But here, most of them take as and when required. Okay. So what I normally try to use in a mild to moderate pain is a high dose of paracetamol, 1 gram, 4 times a day. Although the FDA has put a black box warning of 1 gram, 4 times a day, but I still use it. The toxicity is more than 4 grams, so you're well within the normal limits. So it's a good drug to start with. Of course, there is a lot of mental barrier with individuals here saying that I'm taking 2 tablets 4 times a day, doctor. It will cause me heat and, you know, gas and a whole lot of things. But I think if you convince them, it's a very good medicine. Okay. Now, recently, there's a study which is published from Sydney. It's called a CHAM study, which sort of looked at about 17,000 Sydney residents who have chronic pain. Now, they looked at the guideline, whether they were sort of properly sort of given medications, whether they given PPI with NSAIDs. They found that only 13% of the individuals were using regular non-steroidal drugs. Okay, in that, people who are using regular non-steroidal, most of them were on paracetamol high dose, and people who are on regular paracetamol high dose, they found the pain relief was quite good. But many of the doctors did not prescribe PPI when you're prescribing NSAIDs. That is something that I found out. So if you're prescribing paracetamol, use high dose and use it regularly. It's quite effective. Now, if it's not effective, then you add a very small dose of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. Of course, paracetamol does not have anti-inflammatory property. It's a more analgesic property. How does it act? It acts on the COX cyclooxygenase inhibitor, and it sort of reduces the prostaglandin. It acts on the neutrophils, reduces the secretion of inflammatory mediators, and also it has a central effect, which acts on the NMDA receptors. So that's quite good. But if you're not able to control with paracetamol, start a low dose of non-steroidal. I tend to use naproxen. I think that's my sort of limit there. I tend to use a very sort of, say, a cockroach or allopathic dose. It's 250 milligrams twice a day as a moderate release preparation. That's all. I tend to go up to 500. That's all. I think that's... So most of the time, you do have control of pain. Although NSAIDs are quite a good drug, but they have a lot of disadvantages. They're used only for mild to moderate pain. They have a dose ceiling effect as well, and they carry a serious adverse effects, like, you know, at a short-term GI bleed, worsening of hypertension, and acute renal impairment. And with prolonged use, we noted that there's increased cardiovascular events, chronic renal dysfunction, which is a concern. GI bleed, you need to bear in mind that most of the older patients who have comorbid illness, they are on aspirin, and a lot of them could be on SSRI, which increases your risk of GI bleeds with NSAIDs, non-paracetamol NSAIDs, and also patients who are anticoagulation. So it's better to you give them a proton pump inhibitor as well. And with COX-2 inhibitors, we notice that it is an independent high risk for vascular events and thromboembolic events. Okay, so I tend not to use them very regularly. Now, I tend to come to opioids for my rescue. Opioids inhibits the pain pathway by acting on the opioid receptors, which is in the periaqueductal areas, and they act on three receptors, the mu, kappa, and delta. And most of the opioids that we use clinically act on the mu receptors. Tramadol and tapendol, which are synthetic opioid analgesics with a binary action, they act as SNRIs and as well as act on the opioid receptors. Now, opioids can be divided as agonist, partially agonist, agonist and antagonist, and antagonist. Morphine, codeine, fentanyl is an agonist opioid. Buprenorphine is a partial agonist. Pentazocine is an antagonist and agonist. And naloxone is an antagonist. Now, coming to use of morphine, I have a very good palliative care team, so I work with them. And most of the time, pain can be very, very challenging. And also, it has a very ethical and moral dimension. When somebody is, say, a terminal cancer, the family will request me, good, there's nothing that you could guys do, but at least take away the suffering, take away the pain. I think so you need to have a good team to work with, otherwise it gets very difficult. So I tend to use morphine quite generously, to be honest with you. Morphine is available in different forms. You have oral form, it's called Oromorph. You have tablet, which is morphine sulfate, which is 12 hours acting. We have 24 hours acting. We have rectal preparation as well. But in this country, we just get oral Oromorph that's available only in a couple of institutes. And morphine sulfate is available. So how do you start morphine? If somebody is opioid naive, you start them on a low dose. In an older person, you start them on a 5 milligram rather than a 10 milligram dose and go up on the dose for every 4 to 6 hourly and calculate the 24-hour dose and then switch over to long-acting thing and also calculate the breakthrough pain, okay? And fentanyl is available as a patch, as a 12 microgram per hour patch or 25 micrograms per hour patch. Also, it's available as buccal lozenges in this in Bangalore. So I think that can be used for incidental pain as well. The other drug is oxycodone, which we choose to use. It's quite a good drug, especially in patients who are morphine and they have impaired consciousness or impaired confusion or cognitive impairment with that. So normally we try go switch out to oxynorm and oxycodone. That's quite a good drug. Methadone, we don't use it. Now, codeine is a very good drug, but unfortunately, we don't have codeine. If you combine a small dose of codeine with paracetamol, it has got a good analgesic effect, but we don't get it here. But I think buprenorphine is available as a patch, so I think you could use it as well. But you need to bear in mind that somebody is very frail. If they have a very poor subcutaneous tissue, then the absorption will be a problem. I just want to make a big mention of tramadol, which is available. Tramadol, you could give it as 50 to 100 milligrams every sixth hourly. Okay. Now, it's combined, comes as a combination prescription with combination with the paracetamol, and we have extended dose as well. But the side effects is that most of them have dizziness, vertigo, headache, and constipation. And also, seizures have been reported with tramadol, and also they have serotonin syndrome. If somebody is on tramadol and somebody is on SSRI or SNRIs, they can develop serotonin syndrome. But there's a low rate of abuse compared to morphine. Now, before you start anybody on morphine, you need to check whether is the patient opioid naive. That means patient has not taken opioids at all. And what opioids have been effective for the patients in the past, and what's the patient's age, is renal and liver function. Now, things that we use in patients who have impaired renal dysfunction is that you can use oxycodone or hydromorphine, but morphine and fentanyl is something that we use quite regularly for moderate to severe pain. And you need to calculate the breakthrough dose. Breakthrough dose is the total dose, and 10% of the total dose is called a breakthrough dose. Now, patients with a history of opioid use, you need to start them at a higher dose. You need to be aware of equianalgesic dose if you're switching, but you don't have much of a choice here. But that may not be a problem. When you're rotating from one opioid to another opioid, you need to be aware of what is called as incomplete cross tolerance. Now, most of the side effects, the side effects what you get with morphine is nausea, vomiting, abdominal discomfort. Somebody who's got postural hypotension can get worse with that. But constipation is something that does not go away. It can be a big pain. Constipation, you need to be very generous with the laxatives when you're using morphine. Nausea, vomiting, they do normally come out of it. Pruritus as well, sedation. If you're using within the limited therapeutic range, what you're supposed to use, respiratory depression is not so common, but you need to use a lower dose. Opioid-induced hyperalgesia is something that which you notice because of central and peripheral sensitization in patients who are taking opioids. And serotonin syndrome, as I mentioned, is more common in patients with taking tramadol. Now, what are the adjuvants for chronic pain? Tricyclic antidepressants has been used for a long time. Amitriptyline is a good drug to start with, but I start them at a very low dose, 10 milligrams, for neuropathic pain, for facial pains, and fibromyalgias, and chronic headache, chronic low back pain as well. But you need to be aware that it can, even 10 milligrams can cause dry mouth and sedation and incontinence and fall. So I think you need to bear in mind. It's been licensed as first line for neuropathic pain, and so I think it's used widely. It's contraindicated in patients with glaucoma. But SNRIs is something that I'm a bit puzzled using in this country. SNRIs is the first line of drug according to NICE guidelines for neuropathic pain. But what I noticed is that when I used to use duloxetine at a much higher dose to start with, 60 milligrams to start with, patients used to tolerate well. They never used to have sort of sedation or ataxia and things like that. But here, smaller dose, patients find it very difficult to cope. And also, I see a lot of SIADH with SNRIs, even at the lowest dose. I tend to be very cautious nowadays to use it. Venlafaxine, I do use it as well. With regards to anticonvulsants, gabapentin, I start them on a very low dose for neuropathic pain. And also sometimes for patients with low backache, they may have some neuropathic element as well. And patients with a low backache with a radicular type of pain, gabapentin does help. And especially in patients with who tried amitriptyline, so gabapentin. Sometimes I tend not to use amitriptyline, but I sort of many a times, majority of the times, we tend to control the pain with pregabalin or gabapentin with the low dose of amitriptyline. Carbamazepine is also used, but I don't tend to use it very often because SIDH is very common with carbamazepine, and topiramate is not a very good response for me. Now, steroids, as mentioned in the previous speakers, that are used for specific rheumatological conditions, but in terms of pain, we use it if there's acute inflammation that you need to help them with that. But we also use it in patients with sometimes pain, which just bring down the symptom of pain. You know, sort of if there's inflammation, you bring it down. But I think there is the specific indications for intervention for steroids as well. Muscle relaxants, you use it for acute back pain. But sometimes we use it for patients with chronic stroke with muscle spasms and things like that. Lignocaine patch is quite good. I mean, but you don't have available, it's not available here. It's very well used for neuropathic pain. Capsaicin cream, it's not available here, but it's a very good one. It's an alkaloid which is taken out of the peppers, and it depletes the substance P, and it's sort of it's a very good one for patients who can't tolerate low dose of amitriptyline or gabapentin as a cream. But one of my patients got, somehow managed to get it in Bangalore. I don't know where he got it from, but it's not available. I tried even the cash pharmacy. It's not available. Now, what are the non-pharmacological treatment for pain? Now, spinal manipulation, massage, acupuncture has all been found to be useful in chronic low back pain. TENS has been used as well. There's some sort of effect on that. Exercise, yoga as well. There's something called back schools, which is more of a Swedish initiative, which says that they subjected these patients with chronic back pain to back school. What does it mean? That they tell them all about the pain, why pain happens. They give them all the necessary information and give them the lifestyle changes, and that has helped them in terms of reducing the analgesic threshold, analgesic requirement, and also helped them to have better quality of life. Now, other non-pharmacological are psychotherapy, which is, I used to think it's all mumbo-jumbo, but I think it does have a role to play in a bigger picture. But interdisciplinary rehabilitation, I think it's a biggie. That's the most important thing. You know, when you go to a pain clinic, you see what a transformation it happens. But it takes a long time. You need to sit through the patient, spend more time. Lumbar fusion is also being used for orthopods. I think the gentleman can comment on that. And implantable devices as well. Now, look, we all seen these pyramids, but I think let us do what is the rheumatologist more common or fancy about bridging therapy. Now, you know, you start with paracetamol, good dose, pain more often is controlled, especially it's a mild to moderate pain. You give naproxen and COX-2 inhibitors. Then you can go up to codeine, tramadol, and adjuvants much earlier. Morphine, fentanyl, buprenorphine, and non-pharmacological intervention. And sometimes you need to call upon the surgeons to do that. But look, and the most important thing I want you to take home is that you need to reconceptualize pain. What does it mean? The neurobiology theory of pain says that there is no direct correlation between tissue injury and the pain perceived. In a chronic pain, there's no relationship between injury and pain. There's multi factors involved in pain. And also your brain plays some funny games. That means it perceives an apparent pain which is not there. So you need to orient your patient saying that, you know, this is what is going to happen. You need to foster optimism. And most of them are come with the doom and gloom, having visited a lot of doctors. Now, I think every effort should be made to prevent the vicious cycle of pain. promoting self-efficacy. Now, emphasis on pacing, self-education, relaxation. I think one of the most important thing whenever I deal patients with chronic long-term disease is to get into some sort of understanding and partnership and saying that, look, I'll do my bit of it, you do a bit of it, and that's how it gets better. And I think most importantly, emphasis on patient participation and responsibility. And rehabilitation is the most important thing. If you can do it, it'll be very good. If you can have a pain team, that's really good. But above all, as the previous speaker mentioned, please individualize every patient. Also, guidelines are there to guide us, but I think we need to individualize. Now, the take-home message is chronic pain is an illness. You need to have an integrated, interdisciplinary rehabilitation. Start low and go slow. Emphasis on active patient participation. Set realistic expectations after talking to the patient. I think that's very, very important. Well, I think if you take home this, this is a slide from Star Trek. This is James Kirk and Spock used to play this chess. But the thing is, James Kirk was very good with two-dimensional chess. This is a three-dimensional chess. They do all the same rules, but only thing is it goes in three dimensions. Spock was very good. So who used to win the chess game? It's always a Spock. So I think most of the doctors are tuned to handle pain of one and two dimensions, not in multi dimensions. We need to change gear, we need to change, look at patients from different perspective. So that's how we'll get a handle on the pain. And on a lighter note, there's a quote from Charlie Chaplin. It says that my pain may be the reason for somebody's love, but my pain must never be the reason for somebody's pain. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for the wonderful lecture. I think and I believe that whenever I see the prescriptions or sometimes we are using it, we use possible not optimal dose of the NSAIDs or whatever the drugs when we are taking only treating in terms of pain. Sir, from my side there are two questions which I just flashed me. So what are the common disorders or the pain disorders you see, like both in elderly and young? And rheumatological versus non-rheumatological, and what are the alternative forms of apart from pharmacology, like pharmacological drugs? So, what are the other alternative forms which you commonly use for this pain management?
Okay, thank you, chairperson. The common pain that I see, so the somatic nociceptive pains are low back pain, osteoarthritis. The neuropathic pain is post herpetitis and diabetic neuropathy. And that's what I say. In terms of rheumatology, rheumatoid, sometimes Jacob Matthew refers some patients to me. These are the things. But normally, most of the time, pain is controlled. But I spend a lot of time with my patients just to get a different dimension of pain, what's happening to them, and see them in a real time, you know. Let me give a simple example. The lady who came 2 days back, a 65-year-old lady who's got osteoarthritis, okay. We've done a lot of doctor shopping, and so finally comes here to do something. I tell you very clearly, I don't have a magic wand, okay? So it's a process that you go through. But what has happened to her because of the pain? And she used to manage the cooking. She's not doing the cooking. For a lady, cooking is very important, so kitchen is out. Then she used to visit the local temple. She's not visiting, okay? So I think she's very lonely. She's not very happy that she's not meeting her friends. And what's happening is that she's sort of ostracized and she's becoming more lonely. Okay, so how do I go about it? And every doctor says, you know, she's a bit, she's got a high BMI, she looks very healthy, but, you know, everybody tells lose weight. What do you do? How do you stop? I mean, so what I told her is, look, let us make a pact. I'm going to treat your pain, get it better. I'm not going to get it completely normal. I'll get it better, but you start walking. Okay, you do your bit of it. Okay, so once this, and also tell them, set a realistic target. I'll try to bring down 50% of your pain. Keep your pain diary, come back to me. Okay, I'm here to help you. Okay, and tell them that you set a target of losing just half a kg a month. That is all, nothing more, or 1 kg. So it works. In a lot of my patients, it works over a period of time. It's a process. Okay, it's a process, it works. So what are the things that I use? I use, sometimes there are some places who do give massage, that helps. Acupuncture helps as well, especially with neck pains and low back pain. So it's a combination of things. How much this medicine is working, how much acupuncture is working, it's very difficult for me to say. But put together, patient is more cheerful, more happy, and once they know that things are getting better, they have more handle on their pain, then they take it forward. They are much more happier, you know, they have more control over things.
Thank you, sir. So can we take only two questions?
Benjamin, you talked about morphine and constipation. My experience is majority of the patients in this country, whatever analgesic you use, paracetamol, codeine and all, everybody comes and complains. We are constipated. It looks like the whole country is constipated. Do you use routinely laxatives? Can you advise or any contraindication along with using analgesics particularly, not non-steroidals?
First, constipation analgesics. Okay, now, constipation is a major problem. I fully take your point. But many a time, if you go through the history, what do they mean by constipation? It may not be actually a constipation. But I am very when I say I tend to bring back the bowel hygiene and sleep hygiene as well and try to improve on the diet. But most of the patients want a sort of immediate relief. They don't want to wait for things to improve. As I mentioned in my talk, that the GI motility comes down, they're more prone for, because our fiber content is very low. We are more carbohydrate consuming people where fiber is very low. So I'm not surprised that we have more constipation. But I also use a lot of probiotics, fermented curds, which sort of helps them. But laxatives, stool softeners is something that I use. It helps. But it's all combination of things, you know. And I tell them not to get too upset if you get constipated. But my worry with patients is constipation is one of the risk factors for with constipation is delirium and urinary infection. That is my big concern as well. Now, with regard to pain, I use paracetamol in a high dose, 1 gram, 4 times a day. And some patients are really sort of perturbed that I can give 2 tablets, 4 times a day for a pain. But once it starts working, they're quite happy. They sort of want to continue as well. And then I tell them that you take a painkiller before you go for a walk. So you regulate how you can do that. Once they have a control over things, once they start believing that they can, you know, sort of get on the top of the pain, then I sort of tend to think. But NSAIDs, very, very unusual. If I use it very, very low dose and I take it out very quickly. But I've seen patients going with renal impairment, even the half the recommended dose. So I tend not to use until there's a severe pain and there's a inflammation as well, so which to bring it down. So it's more paracetamol. And I switch over quickly to tramadol and patches.
You didn't touch about phantom pain.
Come again?
Phantom pain.
Oh, phantom pain, I mean, I just mentioned about it. I mean, I use high dose of anticonvulsants, that is pregabalin and gabapentin. And as I told you, I would rather try the reconceptualization technique, which really sort of works, which that's what I learned. And I think it sort of does a lot of world of good to them in terms of thing. It does improve, but it can be a real challenge, having a phantom pain. Yeah.
So last question, please.
Can fentanyl be given as an outpatient in an ordinary clinic? Is it safe?
It can be, yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
In day-to-day practice, can we give this parenteral painkillers like diclofenac and pyraxicam, dolomite, like that? Because they demand, unless we give injections, they are not satisfied.
Yeah, I think that's something issue here, isn't it? I think I tend not to use them. I mean, a lot of people give it, but I think sometimes it gives. One of the ways of building a trust with your patient is to tell him that, look, I'll give this injection, take the edge of your pain, okay? Pain is not occupying your life. It'll take the edge of your pain, take this, but one shot of diclofenac, sometimes I've given it, just to take the edge of the pain and then sort of give them routine medications, routine painkillers to help them with the pain. But I don't continue with diclofenac. I try not to.
Thank you very much, sir.
Question.
We will take up the questions in the. We are
thank you.
Late.
Thank you very much.
So at a lighter note, I just wanted to ask because Sir Chandrasekhar, sir. So I just wanted to wanted you to define the elderly now, because the simple thing is while we are going.
Can I?
Elderly 65, old is
okay. Well, I think I want to say one thing. Best just take home this message. Age is just a number. It's an attitude. Okay, I've seen 85-year-old lady coming, look, I want to do this in life. I have a patient who's 85, who's writing a book on history. Okay, why not? So I think age is just a number. We're going to live longer. So I think we need to look for biological age, not chronological age. So I think that's what it is. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Just a few minutes, please. I request Dr. Vishad Vishwanath to come on the dais and receive memento from Dr. Shiv Prasad. And I request Dr. Vijay Rao to give memento to Dr. Dominic Benjamin. I request Professor Sridharan to hand over memento to Dr. Shiv Prasad. And Dr. Vijay Rao.